So humanitarian crises are happening ever more frequently, growing in scale, whether it's geopolitical conflict, whether it's climate change, disaster. The result? One in 122 humans are now either a refugee or displaced. One in four children live in a conflict or disaster zone. And the outstanding statistic for me actually is the amount on average time that a person spends as a refugee isn't 2 or 3 years, as I initially thought. It's actually 17 years. So when you're dealing with human crisis, humanitarian crisis, you have a short-term problem in addressing it. You also have a longer-term problem. Now, it's how do private partnerships, how do governments, how do NGOs work together better to facilitate responding to these crises, given the changing environment, given the benefits of technology and the challenges they all face. Let me introduce my panel. Peter Maurer, President, International Committee of the Red Cross. We've also got Frank Appel, he's the CEO of Deutsche Post. Ajay Banga, the President and CEO of Mastercard USA. Imad Fakhoury, he's the Minister of Planning, International Cooperation for Jordan. And Filippo Grandi, to the UN High Commissioner of Refugees in Geneva. Guys, I'm going to start just by going down the line. Peter, you can kick us off. Where do you see your role in addressing humanitarian crisis? And what do you see as the biggest challenge?
Well, our role traditionally comes from what states has given us as a role in the Geneva Conventions. It's responding to humanitarian needs at the front line of conflict and violence. And this is where we want to be, as close as possible to the front lines, as close as possible to those causing violence in order to make them respect international humanitarian law, but also as close as possible to the victims in order to stabilize lives and livelihoods of those who are disrupted by war and violence. And that's the reason why in many of the conflicts of the world today, we are in places where many others are not anymore or are not yet there. And I think this proximity is where we see our key role. Then, of course, we are part of the Red Cross and the Red Crescent movement. And here we try to work together to support, to respond in a much broader way along migration routes to support national societies of the Red Cross and Red Crescent all over the world.
Frank, as a corporate here, what do you see as your role and where are you placed in terms of response time in a crisis?
We have a very clear objective. We want to leverage our skills. So as the largest logistics company, we have now worked together with the UN for more than 10 years by deploying, when natural disasters are happening on the spot, our volunteers, and we have 400 well-trained people in logistics and how you help in national disasters, to send them in these places and to organize airports. Because what quite often happens is that there is a big flood of products, but the airports are completely overwhelmed. How you deal with that? How you manage a warehouse on the spot with products which are coming in with aid? And we send our people, and we are doing that. We have a very clear principle. It has to leverage our skills. And on the other side, it has to give something back to our people inside of the company as well. And if you see the feedback of our people around the world, how proud they are, and many of the volunteers are coming from difficult areas. So we are sending them in, and that's all volunteering. And they help really when people are in need. That's one thing. The other one is that we do the same. We train people in potential places where natural disasters are happening, at airports, with the government, how you should respond if your airport is broken down. What can you do? How you can manage the inbound flow? And that is what we call, prepare airports and harbors for the disaster. And that is what we do in cooperation with the UN for a long time already.
Imad, as a Minister of Planning?
Basically, I represent a country that neighbors an unprecedented conflict, probably something we haven't seen since World War II, which is the Syria crisis. So our role, by extension, is we're a country that tries historically and continues to do the right thing. We've kept the borders open. We received hundreds of thousands of refugees as a host country. And we really deal with the entirety of all the types of interventions that different people are going to represent here, because the flow of people comes in, Obviously, the real heroes are the refugees themselves, primarily. I would then say our own citizens in a host country for their patience, their generosity, for accepting, you know, to host all these people. And I'm going to try, hopefully, through this panel, to convey what has been evolving, how we've been doing, what are the lessons learned as a host country trying to deal with this type of a situation, because obviously it's increasing, it's spreading. And I think we're doing quite innovative things in partnership with the UN, the donor countries, the private sector, the international NGOs. We have done tremendously paradigm shift-oriented actions in trying to do what we've done in dealing with this latest crisis that we've dealt with, which is not the first, unfortunately, given our geopolitical location.
AJ?
So I think what I'll go where Frank is, at the end of the day, our role isn't just to write a check. I think if you write a check, there is a limit to what that will do, given the size of the crisis, given the hundreds of millions of people who are impacted. What we try and do is use our technology and our people in a way that enables a self-sustaining solution. So let me give you an example. In their country and in Lebanon, since they're the most impacted with the Syrian refugee crisis, we worked with the World Food Program to, instead of distributing aid in the form of physical grains, man cannot live by grains alone. You give them choice. You give them the same money on a card, which only works in shops inside the refugee camp, cannot be used to buy things that the World Food Program does not want the money to be used for, but can be used to buy eggs and vegetables and milk as well as grain. And in fact, that increases the efficiency of the money by as much as 20 to 30%. And we've done this now for 2 million refugees in Lebanon and Jordan. And if there's one thing I would like to add, nothing to do with the question, I want to compliment him for his leadership and his government. They do a really good job in a very tough environment.
We'll compare and contrast the European response with the Jordanians, but for now, let's just listen in from the UN.
Well, I represent an organization that has a fairly clear task, ensure that refugees, many millions of them throughout the world, are given international protection when they flee across border, that they are properly assisted, and that we search together for solutions to their plight. And we do, together with others, similar work for internally displaced people, you know, total population of these two, 65 million estimated. It's a job that is somehow at the boundary between working with states. We are a United Nations organization, so we work with states. We belong to states. But the mandate, the task, is very people-oriented. So often we have to somehow be between the two. But finally, I want to say, and you know, the colleagues have already mentioned that, increasingly we see that in refugee crisis, these are the ones we deal with mostly, in refugee crisis, humanitarian responses of the traditional kind, where you have humanitarian organization going and ask for money from government and helping governments like Jordan bear the brunt of this crisis. Increasingly, that model is insufficient. Crises are too big, too long, as you pointed out, so we need to work with others. So increasingly, I see a third role, if you wish, for my organization, and I suppose that we share this with ICRC and others, as catalyst to bring others in and to help craft new ways of working together to address this this phenomena, including, in particular, development actors and the private sector.
It's interesting that in everything that you've all said here, it was the immediate response, really, we've talked about. I know the Jordanian situation is slightly different here, but it's all about the immediate crisis response, whether it's the payment system, whether it's getting goods to a crisis and the logistics of getting the food and goods to a crisis. But actually, as we pointed out earlier, it's a 17-year problem for some of these refugees. So we'll talk about the inefficiencies, I think, Peter. You've said that the system we have is not enough, the setup that we have right now.
Well, exactly because of the point you have just mentioned and Filippo has alluded to. I think we have seen a transformation of conflict environments. We have seen a transformation of the dynamics of natural disasters, which become more frequent and impactful. We have seen conflicts which put ourselves in front of challenges which are bigger than what the traditional systems and approaches are used to do. And as Filippo has said, the traditional model is a very simple one. As a humanitarian organization, you collect money and you transform it in humanitarian goods and services for people. And the kind of money we can collect and the kind of services we can transform into today is not sufficient. And that's the reason why what we have seen over the last 5 years is, and all the humanitarian organizations see themselves confronted with the same. Every month we do more in the critical crisis situations of the world, and every month the situation at the end of the month is worse. Because the dynamics of conflicts or the dynamics of natural disasters are faster than what we are able to do. And that's the reason why I think here all in Davos, we are increasingly aware that we need to work together in a very different way.
Where's the gap? Is the gap between manpower? Is it inability to raise enough finance to be able to create these things? Is it a logistic problem? Where is the gap?
Well, the gap is manifold, but I think at the end of the day, the traditional model is good to stabilize societies and to substitute social services when no social services are available to people. But this is not a model which is sustainable. And that's the reason why more self-reliant, more a humanitarian assistance which puts victims into the center in order to strengthen them to find a way out of the problems in which they are needs a completely different way of doing. And then we can compose the different elements of knowledge, skills that we have all from the private sector, from academia, from new technologies, from traditional humanitarian organization. We have to find new ways on strengthening communities and giving them back the power to help themselves. And that's a very different way of humanitarianism.
Ajay, come in here. I know you were...
Yes, I had two things to say. One is I believe that if you want the full strength of the private sector to be devoted to making a substantial difference in this and to take on the resource issue, what you have to do is to create a self-sustaining business model which may operate on a different level of, let's say, profitability, or may require patient capital of different types. But you have to create that. Because otherwise, it's like pushing water uphill. You're just not going to have enough water to get to the top of the hill.
Are you saying humanitarian crisis response needs to be profitable as a business?
I believe that if you do not do that at a lower level with patient capital, you'll find it really hard to get the resources that you need to take on a 17-year challenge for an average refugee. And so, let me explain to you what I'm doing. For example, today, we announced to George Soros something called Humanity Ventures, which is money that he's going to put together with our technology and our skills, with data, in an effort to incubate ideas that could have a long lead time and could be impactful over millions of people. You can't do that without patient capital in large numbers coming through. There's only so much money that governments and NGOs and publicly funded institutions can bring to bear. That's the first thing. The second thing is, I think anybody who's going to be in a camp for 17 years, not only have they been displaced from their home, they've lost their dignity, they've lost their identity, they have nothing left. So what you have to do is to find a way to create for them the basics of dignity and identity. One of the things we're working on is why should every refugee organization have a different identity for the same refugee? If you could get an identity system that works across all of these, and you give it to them one time. So we're working with you and OCHA to create such an interoperable identity system that can work. We won't be the ones taking your fingerprint or recording your material. The government will do that. The UNHCR will do that. But we'll help through technology facilitate that. That, to me, is how you get a self-sustaining model of the right type that gets the full power of organizations like the ones here, but also of commercial enterprises like Frank's and mine.
Brexit.
Let me add to that. I think there are three different, probably different things. One is, like I said, in natural disasters, we are sending in our people in kind somehow. So we don't donate money. We, you know, offer people to help. That's one element. Then on the refugee crisis in Germany, we have 13,000 volunteers who are helping refugees to get connected to the society. The third is we announced yesterday in cooperation with Gavi Alliance, where we have shared values, that this is business for us together with them. So there are different elements, and I think the shared value concept is probably more for the sustainable long term, because as Ajay has just said, you know, business has to make it sustainable for themselves too, otherwise it will not work. On a short-term notice, national disasters, volunteers fall fine, all in kind.
Absolutely.
In a crisis of refugees, volunteering on the spot, great. But for the long term, we have to have a business case somehow as well. That sounds a little bit strange, but it has to be, because then the people are really committed in our organization as well. Otherwise, they will tell me, Frank, you give me the budget, and then you come and say, we have to do this and this and that, and then you come back and say, well, how should we do that?
It needs to be part of the corporate strategy.
It has to be, yes.
Yeah, it has to be built into what you do so that your employees feel the power and the energy of the full organization with it. I'm not saying we all don't do philanthropy. When our company had its IPO, 12% of our stock was put into a foundation that's run independently. Because of the way our stock has behaved, the Mastercard Foundation today has a corpus of $12 billion. And that was put in by the owners of the company at that time. That happens too. But what I'm trying to say is, no matter how much money you put into philanthropy, you cannot get a 17-year problem for each refugee solved purely by relying on philanthropy. You have to create an identity method, a method of giving them the dignity, and a method of creating sustainable solutions. With the UNHCR, we're trying to find a solution in Kenya. By the way, refugees happen to go to the countries that can least afford to have them, right? And so, most of the time. And so Kenya has 600,000 refugees in a country that cannot feed its own people. We're trying to work with them in certain refugee camps to take the idea of smart cities, but not look at smart cities as delivering a pizza by a drone, but caring about how water and education and food reaches people in his camps.
But you have economic zones in Jordan. I mean, what we're not talking about here is the fact that you already have existing communities who actually don't want refugees. Look at Brexit, look at Donald Trump. They're using this fear of refugees and of economic migrants, whatever it is in this situation. Actually, something needs to be done about the communities around them, surely, to make them accept over a longer term period that these people are now here to stay. Come in and talk to us about what you're doing in Jordan.
Well, all the interventions, as I mentioned, are appreciated, but at the end of the day, the incremental, and we're very grateful, support that comes in from the private sector, from philanthropy, from CSR. We're the guys, as a government,
holding it.
We have to deal with the day-to-day reality of absorbing 180,000 Syrian boys and girls in our public schools, and no one is paying for that sufficiently, and having to take them through our public healthcare systems, and so on. So I want to try to reverse this a little bit. And we have to be cognizant of the fact that we're looking at the protracted nature of these conflicts. So let's use the case of Jordan. I think that's important to demonstrate to people. So we're a country of about 9.5 million people, 6.5 million Jordanians, 3 million non-Jordanians. And the Syria crisis breaks out. We have in total now 1.3 million Syrians, half of which are registered with the refugees. That's basically, as a ratio to the Jordanian population, because we have other refugees from other nationalities, is about 20%. Think of the equivalent of that would be 100 million going into the EU, and the EU is about 20 times richer in per capita income. Think that when the refugees get to Europe, it costs 10 times to intervene than if you had spent that money in Jordan immediately to deal with that reality. So I'm saying there are trade-offs that we have to be very cognizant of. I think the principles we all agree to, we have to be holistic. There has to be fair burden sharing. When a country does this, this is a global public good. It means I'm doing this, it's the right thing, but I'm doing this on behalf of the international community. And the international community has to step in and deal with that reality. To deal with what the shortages are, we need to be innovative. So what did we do? We basically, in this approach, we worked very well to develop response plan, ones that bridge the short-term emergency humanitarian response, because that's, yes, at the first time people come in, but then they're staying 17 years, 20 years. And I want to remind everyone, Jordan has 2.8 million registered refugees with UNHCR, historically now, cumulatively, and with UNRWA, which makes us the number one country in the world with a total number or as a percentage of our population. So you need to also start thinking, okay, if a country is going to absorb these refugees, what is its carrying capacity? How many waves before that did it handle? Does it have enough water? We're the second poorest country in water availability. What's my fiscal space as a government? Can I provide support for when the international system fails to sufficiently help us? I can, but at one point, my debt to GDP today grew to 95% by 20 percentage points. So I'm risking the stability of my economy because I'm not getting sufficient aid. I'm getting a lot more aid, but it's not still sufficient to help us do that. So you really have to look at it from that comprehensive perspective.
And your political capacity to take in these refugees beyond the financials and the economics. Filippo, come in here.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to the question that you asked about reactions, hostility. And, you know, that political manipulation of the foreigner, of the refugee, of the migrant, is, you know, largely drives towards exclusion. The reaction is they're dangerous, they take away jobs, they bring insecurity, exclude them, marginalize them. Now, exclusion is bad. Exclusion is bad because it perpetuates the problem and actually does create those issues, does create insecurity, does create a burden, confines in countries with less resources, refugees, to humanitarian assistance for 17 years. So I think that all that we're saying is that we must shift that paradigm. We must actually promote the idea of inclusion, including of refugees. Now, this is very tricky because if populations are very big, like in Jordan or in Kenya, as Ajay said, you have to make sure that the self-reliance that you promote for them, the inclusion in national service, it's not just economic, by the way, it's inclusion in schools, it's inclusion in public services, in security, you know, all that has a cost. And this is where we need to come to the support of states and communities that bear that burden. And this is where approaches that are not humanitarian in the traditional way, humanitarian assistance is still necessary in the initial phase, but at one point you need to come in with new approaches that look at jobs, that look at education, that look at vocational training, at, you know, skills training, you know, making people self-sufficient. And my last point is all this pending, of course, the big elephant in the room that we haven't spoken about, pending a political solution to the conflict that has caused the exodus of refugees, if we're talking about the refugee crisis. So there's many factors that need to be brought together.
But doesn't this go back to the point of Ajay, where he was saying, actually, you can't just expect governments or whoever it is, the corporates, just to keep pumping money in order to facilitate this. If you make it into a business, effectively, you make it profitable, then you can say to these people in these individual countries, in the communities, okay, you're going to take them in, there's going to be a period of transition, but actually, effectively, it will pay for itself. Is that what you're saying?
One more point. I don't know about that. I don't know if humanitarian assistance can become a business completely. Yeah. It can adopt business models, for sure. And I think that it's for the refugees, it's for those that suffer from the consequences that it has to become a self-reliant scheme. You see what I mean? It will always have a cost. It will always have a cost in the end. But we need to address that cost towards long-term and self-reliance and not short-term humanitarian dependence.
What cost? Do you mean financial cost?
The context of running it like a business doesn't mean that you're going to make profits out of it in the way you would normally make profits.
But you did say profitable.
Why? Why do I say that? Because otherwise, if you want me to keep pumping in losses into doing something, there is a point of time when any publicly owned shareholder-held corporation will begin to pull back. That's not what you want. You want my technology and my energy and my passion fully applied to this. You want my people not to leave their humanity at the door when they come to work.
But you can break even doing that. Well, you can have a sense of feel good.
Less so. So I'll give you an example. Different context, not humanitarian, but connected. 3 or 4 years ago, I worked with a number of people who were in this room, actually, to get going on financial inclusion as a commitment. We made a commitment to reach 500 million people with our partners by 2020. We're at 250 million people. in a way, we've opened those accounts. Guess what? I lose money on all of them. We're trying to get people to use them. That's the real, actually, that's when you really win, when they use the account. I'm trying to get governments to put their social benefits into those so people are incented to use them. The World Food Program example was one where that worked. In many others, it doesn't work as well. So don't for a minute believe that I'm saying that I'm going to make returns on this the way I make return on capital or another business. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying watch out for this lack of trust between the corporate sector and such a conversation, because people think that the corporate sector only does stuff when people make a lot of money. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying you make me lose money every day, there's only so much you'll get, and then you're back to the philanthropy, the check writing, and those are very important, but they're not the ultimate solution, because the gap between what we need to solve this crisis and what we have is not a small gap. It's in a trillion plus dollars. You cannot find $1 trillion with any amount of philanthropy in the world. You will not get it.
Peter, come in here.
What I feel very much that this is, discussion is really spot on, but what we miss still is really a solid development on what the two models are and what the interaction between those two models are that we are discussing about. We seem all to agree that the sort of traditional model does its job to a certain extent, the philanthropic public policy financing of humanitarian assistance and protection work. That's fine. But you have developed a new model, and that's, of course, also both representatives from the private sector have developed this new model. And I think this is a model which is insufficiently understood, politically still contested, because whenever you talk about the business model, there is this suspicion that you want to make
money
out of
it's the, trust
the of suffering of people.
Trust deficit.
And we have to explain that this is not the case, and we have to find a completely different narrative.
Absolutely.
Which allows us to have political support for those two models coexisting, but also interacting in order to have better impact.
Who does that?
Yeah,
who does the PR on that?
I may say one point, huh? Because we were just standing over the last couple of months on the gray zone between those two models in trying to promote and having promoted now a humanitarian impact bond. The first reaction from politicians was, you can't make money out of a crisis. We can't support that. But I think then by explaining, by modeling, by trying to approach, you can raise private capital to front load money into humanitarian assistant work, which is impactful, which has a long-term dimension, and which is of interest to the business community as well as to the humanitarians, and first and foremost to the victims.
Why can't you make money out of a crisis? You didn't cause the crisis. It's a way of getting sustainable funding in. Why are you so afraid of actually making it a viable investment?
Because
it's doing good.
The refugee's already suffered enough, or the person who's been impacted has already suffered enough. If they're the ones paying for you to make the profit, that's a bad model.
But the money's coming in.
But if
the people wouldn't invest otherwise, the money's coming in.
So you need another way to get the money through.
How?
It could be from the different sources that are in there. For example, let's take the example of the World Food Program. The retailer who was selling that grain and vegetables is also incurring the benefit of that payment, not having to handle cash, gets the electronic payment, gets the money done, they share a part of that cost. For as I'm concerned, if that reduces the cost of the World Food Program, that's a good thing. So I believe if you ask the consumer who's already an impacted refugee to end up and you portray them as being the end impacted individual from whom we are making money, that's what adds to the trust deficit. That's not the way it should be. It should be done in a form that allows you to ensure that the impact to them is de minimis, while at the same time, the benefits are given to them.
And can I add one point to this? Because mm-hmm. I think this is a very important issue.
Yeah.
And the point is that if you make the victims pay, although maybe this is a bit of a simplistic approach to the more complex issue you're raising, but if you make the victims pay, then it's only those who can pay that get help. And I think we need to respect the fact that this in this type of situations, you have to help everybody. You cannot make a distinction. It's not a competition for resources. Everybody, even those that are not skilled, that are not able to contribute financially, have to get assistance. So I think that universality of humanitarian assistance is one principle that needs to be preserved.
So are you saying it has to be a more broad solution? It can't be country by country. It has to be a global solution that everybody buys into.
And nobody needs to be, can be penalized by these new models. Otherwise, you develop another problem by trying to solve one.
But let me come in here. And I think the issue is not the question of can you make it profitable or not, or can you make people pay for it. I think the issue is what we're trying now to innovate in Jordan with many partners around the world, which is, can I look at the refugee crisis and turn it into an economic development opportunity? So what did we do? And that's important for people to understand. First, most people think of refugees as refugee camps. In the case of Jordan with the Syrian refugees, 90% are outside the camps. They're all across our towns and villages.
Village.
They're already spread out. So when people come and visit the refugee camps and they say, thank you, you're doing a great job with UNHCR and so on, but that's only 10% of the challenge. So what have we been trying to do differently in that? We actually went as government first and lobbied very hard that development financing in the World Bank, I'm classified as a middle-income country, so I get a certain rate on development loans. Given that I'm neighboring a crisis, I'm doing the right thing, could they give us reduced loans that allows me to do development? And we launched, based on that initiative, it took us a year and a half of Jordan arguing with the international community. It's such a common sense thing. Make the loans that I'm doing development projects in host communities that help my that help my own citizens, but at the same time that can also carry some of the burden of the refugees who are living in these host communities, make it cheaper. And we did. We did this finally 2 years late into the process. And we launched the concessionary financing facility of the World Bank, which got adopted in September. And we did the first time ever that this international rating system of middle income, upper income, low, does not matter. If you neighbor a crisis, let the money follow the refugees in the same way we do in climate change. Let the money follow the carbon, in essence. Another innovation we started to do is we pushed and negotiated with the EU. Could you give us simplified rules of origin to give us free trade access to the EU? If we use our development zones, employ partly refugees in them and the rest Jordanian labor, these manufactured products, could they get an advantage given the burden we are doing? And we did. We negotiated. It took us 7 months. We've done an incredible thing. And now we're trying to call on the private sector, the international private sector, to think of not of CSR. Come establish manufacturing facility. Employ Jordanians and Syrian refugees in these development zones all across the country. Make money out of it, but help us sustain a self-reliance to refugees who then would have jobs. They can then pay for themselves, lower the burden, and sustain the reality that this is going to take a long time. And one final comment. And we've also pushed UNHCR, instead of importing things outside the economy, give them cash so they buy stuff from the domestic
economy. Only 3%, instead isn't it? Of the only international 3% NGOs, is cash. It's all goods.
Yeah, instead of the international, finally, sorry, NGOs bringing so many outsiders, employ locals, help us carry the burden by being that innovative and thinking of the wider economy.
What he's saying is you have to move your lens away from the traditional way into this other way, which is not easy and it's complicated. And by the way, there's no silver bullet. There'll be 20 different things to be done. That's basically what he's saying.
It's interesting that a middle income, as you described yourself, country, can get themselves organized this, and yet richer nations, I'm using Europe as an example here, actually can't get themselves together to organize some things. But the EMDM debate here is an interesting one. But the other thing here that occurs to me is that you have to accept then that they're going to stay in order to start facilitating, creating this kind of structure. You have to openly accept that they are going to remain. And I think we have a problem there too.
Can I maybe...
Please.
Comment?
And although Frank, I know you were going to jump in as well.
I want to give other colleagues, but I'll come back.
Better place to comment on this, but not necessarily. Because we're talking here about protracted situations.
Yes.
You know, the general, the traditional approach that we all think needs to be overcome is to say, the refugees, therefore humanitarian assistance forever. This is a model that after 5 to 7, 8 years exhausts itself. So now we need to shift to another one because we know that unfortunately lack of political solutions causes protracted situations. But this doesn't mean that these people have to stay forever. In fact, this model is very good for refugee situation because investment in self-reliance, investment in education, investment in skills prepares them for when they go back to their country. So actually it has a double effect that it relieves the burden
on the host country. Or to migrate to richer countries
or to go to another place. So it has multiple benefits that I think needs to be
found. Okay, I want to stop because I want to get some questions from the audience as well. But a couple of times we've used the word trust. Ajay, I know you mentioned it too. So do the NGOs trust the corporates here to come up with a more feasible, financially viable solution to a longer-term crisis? Is the trust there?
Well, trust comes through concrete action. And I think with regard to what we have done at ICRC over the last 5 years is intensifying those areas of practical cooperation which establishes trust. And where the ones see what the interest of both sides is in establishing such a cooperation. So we have expanded concrete cooperation and finding solutions to concrete problems. And this is the basis on where we can then find understandings on broader systems and how to interlink those broader systems.
Do we need greater communication?
I think there is not trust from the beginning. Trust comes through concrete action and finding the common interest that in working together, we find better solutions. And I think it needs leadership. That's what we are discussing here in Davos. It needs finding those practical solutions and finding the common interest from the private sector and organization.
I think trust comes from transparency, what we are doing. So we, you know, our corporate social responsibility is a core part of our strategy. That's, you can find that on our websites, you know, any partner, and some are more skeptical at the beginning, and usually that turns around and we have start working, because then they see this is not only just they want to do something for the brand or whatsoever, they really have, you know, interest in helping. And what I think is important is you always should think when we help, it has to be sustainable later on for the country. That's the reason why it has to be a business model. If it's not a business model, it's not sustainable. And then you walk away, or the people who donate money forget that because it's already 3 years and they don't donate, and then it's not sustainable. And I think that's very important, that we have to set up things which are sustainable. And that's the reason why we talk about shared value. It is not necessary for disaster recovery because that's a, you know, immediate issue. Volunteering is fine. Donation is fine. We don't have to be paid for that. But if it's sustainable longer term, it has to be a shared value project where we have benefits, the country has benefits, the partner who's doing that as an NGO does that. Otherwise, it will not be sustainable. If the NGO goes away, we go away, or the government loses the interest.
And I want to ask you about trust in the governments here to respond to, but I want to take some questions from the studio audience too. And John Studinski, Vice Chairman at Blackstone, is going to have a quick question.
Thank you. Very important discussion. This could probably last for about 3 or 4 hours. It seems to me you need to segment this discussion between situations which have a geopolitical origin versus situations that have a natural disaster, either earthquake or flood or whatever. So, and they're very different. But one of the things that we're not talking about here at all, and I think, you know, one of the reasons why Jordan has been so unique in handling the refugee crisis is, you know, as I would say, it's about leadership, it's about culture. The King and Queen of Jordan are a class act in terms of their humanitarian ethos. Mm. There's no question about that. Thank you. And let me say, I was not asked to make that comment, but that's totally coming from my own, because I've been to Jordan, I've been to Syria, and I've seen this, and that they're doing it because it's just deep sort of humanitarian ethos, and it's very genuine. But as we go around the world, over 100, 150 countries, and all of you know, and I'm looking at Mastercard here, you know, we all know that every country, in some cases, the fish rots from the head, in other cases, there's great leadership at the top. So we have this And no one's really talked about the role of the leadership in the country in a transparent way. No one's talked about the transparency of communication. Because one of the things about these crises is, in the first 1 to 2 weeks, or even 1 to 2 days, there's one set of issues. You know, yeah. Médecins Sans Frontières, the Red Cross, other people. Then after about a week, it's a question of food and water and disease. Then there's another phase. Then there's a third phase that has to do with medical advice, vaccines, you know, public surge and all of that, getting sort of discombobulated. So there's a total lack of communication there. And I wonder, as I sit and look at this group, where do you have threads of, you know, a network? You've got global diplomatic networks. You've got Swiss ambassadors all over the world. You've got American ambassadors all over the world. You have British ambassadors all over the world. You have Chinese ambassadors all over the world. So why can't the international diplomatic corps play a bigger role here? Because the thing that's lacking in all these crises is short-term leadership and sort of what I call disaster or crisis management. Because from the outside, there's no perception of crisis management. But you also have an ability now, and we've seen this, that people can raise an enormous millions of dollars within 2 or 3 days around the world. You saw that in the earthquake in Bengal. And I'd love the reaction to it, because I worry that if you remember all the people that gave money to Bengal, 1 or 2 or 3 weeks later, people still had not had food delivered. And so there was a whole question of logistics, which I understand that. So I've raised about 10 issues. I don't mean to be difficult, but I'm just worried that there are some fundamentals here. We're talking about some basic operating and management logistics, some leadership issues. Who's ultimately on first base here? Who's responsible for communication? And ultimately, this has to be about money. And we didn't talk about the power of social media. It's not just about corporations, because social media today can raise an enormous amount of money in a very short period of time, because people, particularly the millennial generation and the Generation Z, they're extremely generous. And even if they're each giving $5 or $10 or a dollar, that can have a big impact in a very short period of time.
Okay, start with governments. Start with the government response, because we do have a very specific example there.
This is very much a question of leadership and a nationally owned process. And my advice, I think what we've learned over the many decades in Jordan, because you know our geopolitical location, it's been 60, 70 years that we've been always receiving floods of refugees. It's not the first time. And it's very much a question of, there is something in the Jordanian genetic code that has been built over the years. People say, let's visit Jordan, they're very hospitable. And it's true, not just for tourists, they're very hospitable. And I think that's a reality, with all humility, I say it, that we've had to deal with around us.
We're all coming.
What I'm trying to say, and it comes back to the trust, and it bridges the leadership. My advice in these situations, and I think this works very well, you have to have a framework. The government has to coordinate the players. Right. Because this is where you get the breakdown. You get multiple people doing different things that are not a priority. So in Jordan, we did a government-led plan called a response plan that bridges humanitarian and long-term development, what we call resilience plans. It's based on vulnerability assessment. So we said, what are the needs of refugees inside camps, outside camps? What are the needs of our own host communities absorbing the refugees? And what does the government need to continue providing public services? Those plans were put together in a joint approach. The NGOs, the UN agencies, the donors, we sat in task forces for months. We developed them, we prioritized them, but the government led the process and we asked everyone to stick to that framework. I think that's very critical, so you don't waste resources and you meet the must-do activities under all the things you need to do to get the trust and to divide the roles of everyone correctly.
So very quickly, just to address John's point about the fact that there's a different response to a geopolitical crisis versus something perhaps like an earthquake, would that matter in your case? Would all those processes work the same way?
That framework works correctly across
the board.
I think that's important. Critical.
It shouldn't matter. You should have a model.
Can I just add a point here? Of course, Jordan is a very ideal case, as you said, or a very positive case, where you have a lot of things coming together, contributing to make it a good response. Remember, a lot of the problems we have to deal with, be they refugees, displaced, natural disasters, are in countries where the government is either not able not capable,
doesn't have the capacity.
Or may I say not willing, or sometimes is even the cause of the problem. So there is where the challenge is very big. And this is where the challenge of the model that we have discussed becomes really very, very difficult, because those approaches that we are ready to learn with trust from the business communities and others need to also be adapted to a situation where it will be messy, very messy.
I just wanted to emphasize here, while I understand that in cases that you question, there is always a possibility to do better amongst many of the actors, to have a clearer framework, and the Jordanian ministers have mentioned it. My main problem in most of the crises today is not the crowded environment where we are maybe under-coordinated. My problem is the absence of humanitarian actors in some of the most protracted crises of the world, and the deliberate objection of belligerents to let humanitarian actors help the civilian populations.
By the country themselves.
State and non-state actors. Yeah. This is the real problem. That's where the implosion of fragile societies happens. That's where the big population movements come from. That's what is pondering on the bills of the international community. That's where the real problems are. So it's not the sophistication of coordination models. Again, I agree that we can do better, but it's at the end of the day, the unwillingness to have humanitarian laws and principles and practices and frameworks, which have been agreed upon for 150 years by the international community, really implemented in some of the most fragile contexts.
So to go to John's point where he said, you know, days after a crisis, the measures, the things, the food, the facilities, whatever it is, the water, hasn't got through to them. Is that down to the country themselves, or is that down to the time it takes, the coordination, dysfunction perhaps between organisations? Like, do all the NGOs, the immediate response, talk? Do they know exactly what's going on? Is that coordinated? Or do we need someone overseeing that
at
first?
At the field level, coordination does work pretty well.
Pretty well? Amongst is that good enough?
Amongst those who are there, coordination works. The problem, again, is where nobody is there. And that's the real problem, and where you have objective obstacles to get into a situation where the most, where the civilian population is most affected.
OK, I'm going to cut this down then. I'm going to narrow it to an area where we've got a crisis and we don't have the problem of government saying, hey, you can't come in and help us. Let's talk about Europe. Let's narrow it down. Would a situation that AJ was talking about, the kind of model, self-sustaining model that you're talking about, if you had something like that in place already in anticipation of a crisis, further refugees, we can't stop wars, we can't stop displaced people, we can't stop conflicts, we can only react to what happens. Would that work in a country where you can get access, you can get facilities, that's not a problem? Would it work?
I think you're mixing up two issues of political and social acceptance with the ability to get it done in a country that has infrastructure. The second one's not a problem, but you can only operate there if you're welcomed. You can't operate there if you're not welcome.
But if you can make it self-sustaining, if you can make it self-financing, then I think you have a message then to an unwilling population, particularly in Europe where populism is a problem, that, guys, we can help these people without actually hurting ourselves.
Although I would say that the circumstances, I don't live in Europe any longer, but the circumstances in Europe go beyond just the financial cost of looking after the refugees. It goes to a very deep social challenge that Europeans feel about the issue. So what I'm trying to say is that I think financially is one angle. What we are proposing is not a panacea for all the different circumstances in different countries around the world. I think the European situation is much more complicated than just a financial circumstance.
And if I may add, and answering your question, you know, of course, the European situation, I fully agree with Ajay, is complex. You have many factors, political factors, social factors, cultural factors. You also have a financial factor. Assisting refugees in Europe is tremendously
toxic.
Well, it's tremendously expensive. partly because Europe has built very sophisticated asylum system. They cost money. So there is an element there. I think that one thing that we have perhaps overlooked, including ourselves over the decades, is that we dealt with Europe just by in normative terms. You know, we thought that Europe could benefit from our advice in terms of how they received people, judge whether they were refugees or not, et cetera, et cetera. But then those that were refugees, we left them with Europe because we thought Europe has the resources to absorb them. We now realize that perhaps that process of refugee integration in Europe was not as good and successful as it should be. And the backlash that you see now, which in part is also the result of failed integration one or two generations later, is something that needs a lot more attention.
And
we're not tremendously competent in that area, but I think that we need to make an effort to work with European governments in that direction.
Yeah, and I think the challenge with the refugee problem is, first of all, that we put it completely out of proportion. You know, we call that the biggest crisis since whatever. It is not a crisis, you know. It's 1.5 or 2 million refugees who are coming for Europe in a region of 500 million people. What you have to do is, and we do that as a company, you have to get the people in contact with your own employees. So whenever you talk to our employees, and I do that, before they have met refugees, they say, oh. After they have met them, they say, these are the same people as we are. They are very nice people. And then you say, where's the problem? Yeah, but this is whom I know. The others might be a problem. We put these kind of things very often completely out of proportion. And it's not a problem for Germany to digest 1.5 million refugees. It's not a problem. It's not true that this is a problem. What we have to learn is to deal with that. And that's the reason why we are helping the civil servants. We still have to give it to the government to do the administrative stuff. We give empty capacity of our warehouses so that they can build refugee camps in these places. We give money to our volunteers, our money to help them to do something on the spot. So you can overcome these challenges. And whenever I talk to the people who have done that, they say, it's not such a big problem like I read in the newspapers. And I think we have to be clear, this problem of the refugees in Europe is completely out of proportion. The refugee problem in Jordan or in Syria and whatsoever, that's a real problem, but not what real. And we have to say that, otherwise the people really believe that this is the biggest problem Europe has faced for a long, long time, and that's not true.
Well, the way we dealt with it made it into a far bigger crisis than perhaps it needed to be too, but would those people say the same thing after the Berlin attacks? Because we haven't actually addressed the terrorism angle here, which is also part of the circle of fear that leads to communities being quite fearful of the refugees. What's the first thing we can do to make this better? Because I think what we've done here is talk a lot about the problems, and I want to end on a more optimistic note. And Peter, you said it. Look, we've got something here that's addressing it. It's not enough. We need to push forward. What do we need? Because we have a great example, but for many reasons, the model doesn't fit. Can the media help to go to John's? But I realised we actually didn't get any more questions in. I'm so sorry, that's terrible. So I know you wanted to, and before I say anything, please tell me it's a positive thing. I was trying to finish on a positive note there.
Claude Biglier, Swiss Parliament. The question would be, isn't the definition of a refugee today a bit obsolete based on the Geneva Conventions, 1952? It's somebody who is personally persecuted. The reality today, it's a mixed bag of persecuted bombs, which is not personal, economic, looking for better opportunities, sometimes climatic. I was asking whether there is a chance to modify the definition to have a broader. I was told the political climate in most of the countries in Europe is not there, but I'd like to hear proposals of having a definition of the refugee which corresponds to the reality today. And the second, believe as well that we could act preventively. We should invest in the countries of origin. And I'd like to have your views on how much can we invest? Can we do it together, probably more multilaterally than everybody isolated? And what is the minimum critical mass in order to have an impact and really make sure that people looking for better perspectives choose to stay where they are?
Okay, so we've got two things there. We've got economic migrants, which is clearly a problem, and then you've got a situation where you invest in a country. I guess you have to assume after the war ends to enable the people that you're talking about to be able to go back to their homes? You can't assume that, I guess. Filippo, talk about it.
Well, I just wanted to answer, since I think the first question addresses me directly on the Refugee Convention. I think, you know, the Refugee Convention is a very interesting document. If you read it, it's 65 years old, but it's quite valid still. The fundamental principle is that refugees are people whom, if you send back home forcibly, risk their lives. This is not true for all people on the move. Mm. It is true for refugees because they flee. Of course, in 1951, the focus was on persecution. This was Cold War, so it was persecution. It was an instrument in that context. I think over the years, UNHCR and states have interpreted very widely, in a very dynamic way, the convention. Today, most of those that we call refugees are people fleeing conflict. Persecution is an aspect, but not the primary one. So it's the interpretation can be quite wide and quite stretched, but I think one has to maintain that notion that refugees need international protection because they don't enjoy anymore, for that period of time, the protection of their own state. That is still valid. If you erode that, you won't get any better in the present political climate.
I have to wrap up. I want to go back to what I asked you in the beginning, and I said, what's your role in this? And in light of the discussion that we've had, the challenges we've talked about, how you go about tackling it, can you think of a way that you can do this better, that you could all do this better, whether it's government, public sector, the NGOs? Just a sentence. How can you be better in your role? What's needed here? Is it communication, greater trust? What is it?
If I may, one sentence, I would recognize today that my own organization will not be able to survive on a single humanitarian model. And that basically what I would aspire is that we are able to work in different models. We have discussed them today. Mm. And that we improve of what we have done well in the past, and there is room for improvement everywhere. But then we become skilled in developing this model that we have discussed today, which is a more long-term, self-reliant, more a different way of responding to a different type of humanitarian crises, and we should be able to work two levels. And I think that's the challenge for many humanitarian organizations, but it's doable.
Mm. Frank?
Yeah, to be honest, I think we have found a pretty good model how we select what we should do, what we shouldn't do, and that has helped us. Nevertheless, there's always opportunity for improvement. I think we have not leveraged our capabilities to extent which would be possible in very different areas. So, you know, my objective would be that we even do more in leveraging what we are good at to a broader, you know, to more opportunity somehow.
I think my message is very simple. Invest in the demonstration models that can be successful. Reward those models so that others can learn from them. And in the Jordan case, I think we've done incredibly pioneering things with all our partners, the UN, the donors, the private sector. Well, every day we're innovating something. Put the spotlight on it, reward it, invest in it preventively. That's important. It will indicate then the incentive system for other countries, what they need to do. And if they see that Jordan got more aid because they did the right thing, they'll be better positioned to behave better, because at the end of the day, the crisis is going to hit them, the refugees are going to cross the border, and it's going to happen. So there's the right way to deal with that and the wrong way to deal with that.
And it's an incentive structure that's needed. AJ?
I'd say the first thing second, what he just said about the narrative and the tangibility of things getting done. I think our real challenge is our own capacity building. We're bound by the limits of our own imagination. Because this is not something that we did for a living till a few years ago. And now we have good people, a number of whom are sitting here, who are involved with all this. We're bound by the limits of our own imagination. We go to these organizations and say, hey, we could do this together. What about the five things we haven't thought of? And to me, that requires a different way of investing in our people and of allowing their, almost the wrong word to use, but I want their animal spirits to come into this space as much as they go to making money for the company. Then I think we can get a whole new scale of operation.
Yeah.
And my final point would be that, again, using refugees as the lens there. You know, refugees are foreigners, often coming in large numbers, often troublesome. To accept them, to give them that protection that I spoke about, required, beyond the tangible, an effort of solidarity. And we, the governments, Red Cross movement, NGOs, the traditional model, we've spoken about this for so long. We need other partners, because partnering with private sector, partnering with development, the World Bank, the big financial institutions, not only brings the model, helps us with the model that we've spoken about, but is a multiplier of solidarity. And that, in today's world, is gold.
That's an upbeat entrance.
It is. I'm very happy with that. With or without a government. Thank you, your panel. Well done. Thank you.